All right, everyone. Can everyone hear me? No, there we go. Is that better? All right. Let me see if I can work this out to get it a bit higher. Okay, cool. Welcome, everyone, to Tedderfield Air Park, which I think that for today we can call Sean's Air Park. For the celebration of Sean's life, we're all here. We're all here to honor our memory of who Sean was to each and every one of us. Now, traditionally, my role would be a priest. However, Shannon asked me to do the Master of Ceremonies, and I feel incredibly honored to be stepping into that role. I would, however, ask you all, in light of that, for the rest of the day, to refer to me as Dominie. I hear the music has stopped, but I'd like to apologize to everyone for the music you're going to hear during the course of the day. It's a playlist that Sean has put together on Spotify over the last 5 or 10 years, and I'm afraid he had absolutely terrible taste in music. It's one of the reasons I loved it so much when Shannon came flying with us, because she would take control of the music and play lovely music. There is a kind of order of events. I'm not going to go through it because it's a bunch of people speaking. But the first person I would like to ask to come up and talk is actually Paul Russell's daughter. Paul is Sean's brother. Paul has written a beautiful eulogy, but understandably, he's too emotional to read it out now. So can I ask Skylar to please come up and read the eulogy written by Paul.
Good afternoon. I am reading this on behalf of my dad, Paul Russell. Whenever I think of Sean, I remember his smile, his expressive way when he spoke with his hands, in the wild gestures as he narrated a story, and his dry sense of humor. It saddens me that I'll never see that smile or hear those vivid expressive stories again. His taste of music I will not miss. But looking back at his life and all the people here today and how he touched so many people's lives, that has left us lasting memories in all of us. The knowledge, kindness, and free spirit that he shared with all of us is a gift. I take comfort in the fact that he went out what he loved the most. Sean loved the skies and could just about fly anything if he had wings. And he has passed his passion on to his daughter. I am so proud of Shannon, as I can see the same passion and love with flying. As a father, he was amazing, a dad that we can all only try to live up to. To all of us that knew him, he was there for us. In one phone call, he would be there. In mention that you're in trouble, he'll give all his time to help you. In these crazy times and never-changing world, Sean was our constant. His death will never change that fact. He used to be everywhere around us, and suddenly he's gone. That has left us a massive void in all of us. He lived life to the fullest every day, and I'll always remember him for that. I'd like to quote a saying, a brother is there to help us be confident when timid, to be strong when weak, and be fearless when scared. He's an inspiration, and his memory will be in our thoughts forever. Rest in eternal peace, but your living mind and our thoughts forever. Thank you.
Thank you, Skylar, and thank you, Paul, for those lovely words. A hell of a lot of that resonates with me. Same memories I have of Sean. One of the things I loved most about Sean, I mean, there were many things, but one of the things I loved most about him was he was resourceful. There was nobody I knew who could make a plan, fix something broken without the right tools, without the right materials. Sean was resourceful. And it actually, just while you were talking, it reminded me of a Sling Africa tour I think a couple of people here were on the tour. We went to Madagascar. And on the return flight from Antananarivo to Vilanculos over the ocean, which was supposed to be about a 10-hour flight, we had a prop failure midway over the ocean. Sean was not fazed at all. He started rocking the plane and telling me to turn the prop switch on, off, on, off, on, off, on, off, until we gained some pitch. Turned the prop off. Flew the plane onto Vilanculos, landed 5 hours after dark at the international airport. Nobody there to welcome us, no one to take US dollars for customs, which was a relief. But also, we had to get this airplane the whole way across Africa to Namibia the very next day to display it at the Namibian International Air Show. And I can tell you, there was absolutely shithole chance of getting parts flown out from South Africa to Mozambique in 2 hours. So in the morning, off Sean trotted in his traditional shorts, showing his white legs. And he went and found a scrapped car, and he bought the alternator from the scrapped car. He then brought it back to me, and he borrowed my Leatherman, the only tool we had with us. He took the alternator apart with my Leatherman, removed the brushes from the alternator. He then had to reshape them because they were the wrong size for the prop. He used a stone to do that, a rock on the floor. He convinced me, it's fine, Andrew, trust me. So we went to the airport, and he had a great plan. He said, Andrew, you carry 2 25-liter containers of petrol in through customs, because they will jump on you when you do that. While they're jumping on you, I'm going to sneak in around the side, open the cowling, and I'm going to fit this part. And I kid you not, 30 minutes later, we were wheels up on our way to Namibia, and we made it in time for the air show. I mean, that is actually the real MacGyver. Next up, I'd like to ask James Pittman, one of Sean's great friends, colleagues, my brother, and one of the biggest supporters of Sean that I've known over the years, to come and say a couple of words. James.
Hello, everybody. What a wonderful turnout. A collection of most of the people that Sean loved most in his life. It's wonderful to have you here. And of course, the only really sad thing is that we don't have here today the one guy that we really need to get this event together. You know, Sean was always the guy who opened the hangars, put up the TV sets, made sure that the power worked, the parking for airplanes. And of course, he was the one who organized the airplanes, and typically, he was the one also who flew the airplanes. So, it feels fitting to me that we're celebrating Sean's life in a hangar, because more than anything else in the world, with the exception only of his friends, and especially his family, Sean Russell loved to fly. And right now we are standing in the Sling Final Assembly hangar. This is the hangar in which Sean, over the last 10 years of his life, has overseen the assembly, completion of, and then has himself flown, test flown, more than 200 Sling aeroplanes. And I've always felt that the first flight of an aeroplane is an emotional moment. It's something like the birth of a child. It's a moment when, in aircraft terms, flesh turns into spirit, and the inanimate becomes spiritual and animated. Life is breathed into the inert. So it's sad that we are here today, not to celebrate a new life, but the end of a life. I do think, though, that in exactly the same way as Sean breathed life into Sling Aircraft that came out of this hangar over a long period of his life, for us, all of his friends, he breathed joy, excitement, amazing experiences, and for very many of us, a huge amount of adventure. And it's a tribute to the person that he was and the love that people bore for him and do continue to bear for him that we are all here today. I'm not a member of Sean's immediate family, but Mandy, Shan, Paul, in the 72 hours after we heard news of Sean's death, I counted last night the WhatsApps that I received, and there were more than 85 WhatsApps of condolence that I, just as a friend and colleague of Sean, received. I don't think that there's a Sling owner in South Africa who has not benefited from Sean's incredible knowledge, but even more than his knowledge, his generosity and his willingness to help people all the time, wherever they may be, in whatever place. No problem was ever too big for Sean, and no effort too much. It was never too late to phone, and it was never too late to obtain advice from him. He would travel anywhere in the country, usually in a Sling airplane, to come and help us. Actually, Sean's ability to assist aircraft owners extended well beyond the bounds of South Africa and into all the neighboring territories and throughout the entire world. And that is because, actually, Sean was a Sling whisperer. He was a man who understood a Sling aircraft like no other human being on earth. He knew these systems so well that he could identify a problem across half of the world. So typically, what would happen is that someone on the other side of the earth would phone Sean with some problem or other out in the field. And Sean would ask four or five questions, and then he'd come up with some little quick test. The person would do the test, he'd instantly identify the problem, come up with a solution, and hey presto. You know, somebody some years ago showed me a powerful computer that was able, with 20 yes-no questions, to determine whatever object you may be thinking about on Earth. But I can tell you, Sean Russell's ability to get under the skin of and understand the problem in a Sling aircraft made that computer look like a preschooler. I mean, interestingly to me, Sean was ordinarily not an avid reader, except for on those occasions when he deemed that a problem that he had come across required the solution of RTFM, which, as most of you will know, means read the fucking manual. That was the one occasion that he was willing. Instead, he was really a profoundly practical person, Sean. And I know that from a young age, Sean was always fiddling and always fixing and always building things. He was a beautiful model builder. He was an accomplished wood carver. I have an aircraft which he carved for me early in my relationship with him. And he was a beautiful sculptor. I mean, really, he was a natural artist, and he had a wonderful eye for the beautiful and the efficient. I think that Sean was an exemplar of a certain quality which I think is increasingly rare in the world. It's the quality of a hobbyist, of a human being who is able, just with his hands, the application of his brain, and a massive store of knowledge and experience to fix and create very, very complex objects, something we see much, much less often in the youth of today. You know, Sean's interest was much less in computers and the abstract than in gizmos and physical Newtonian gadgets of the real world. And all of us benefited from that because so many of us have had him rescue us out there in the felt in our kind of moment of greatest need. There's no time really to read all of the beautiful emails and messages that we've received post Sean's death. But I want you to just take one as an example of the kind of emails that we've been receiving from those that loved him. This comes from Trevor Hennigan and his partner Lizzie Began. They're an English couple, and they came here to South Africa 3 years ago to begin building and to build a Sling 4 TSI with our help. And when they completed that build, and after COVID, they had an absolutely wonderful adventure in which they flew that aeroplane across Africa and back to England, also via Madagascar. And it's but a typical example of one of many emails that I've received from people who benefited from Sean's incredible commitment to helping others. It says, "Dear James, we were devastated to hear the tragic news of Sean's fatal accident at Bass Lake. It was such a shock, having flown with and known Sean's amazing skills as a pilot. Such an unfathomable catastrophe for him and his passenger. What an awful start to the new year. Please send our deepest condolences to his family and to his friends. He was a huge character, and he will be missed by everyone that knew him. Such a loss to the Sling team and the aviation community to which he dedicated himself. Sean's passion and keen eye for detail was always welcome in our long journey from build to flight. Even when he was at his busiest, he would try to find time to give us his thoughts about our concerns. An amazing test pilot for which we will always be very grateful. On the day of our very first flight, when we were looking a bit nervous, he said, 'Do I look nervous? I'm not nervous.' And he went on to take her up and put her through her paces. It was a huge moment for us, and we will never forget that we shared it with him. Our expedition into the Indian Ocean and up through East Africa to the UK last year was a huge challenge and such a rewarding experience. Apart from some tricky weather, we had a couple of occasions when we were faced with a red lane light. One of these happened to be on our first five-hour ocean crossing from my yacht. A nerve-wracking experience that recurred in our flights over Kenya. After talking to Sean, he helped us to diagnose the problem, typical, and he then provided us with a video of how to solve it. He was right, of course. We did as the video directed, step by step, and to our huge relief, there were no more problems for the rest of the trip. Sean was always ready to share his knowledge and help any pilot in a bind. He did all of this because he wanted people to fly and enjoy their flying. He trained pilots, encouraged builders, and helped those who were already on their way to keep going and to fly well. Such a force of nature leaves a huge hole in everyone's life. We will remember him as a man full of energy for his passion, flying. Our deepest sympathies go to you and the Sling team, to Danielle, and most of all, to his daughter Shannon, who must be in pieces with her father gone. You are in our thoughts. There are countless stories about Sean. I mean, we could spend a whole day. And I've had a lot of adventures alongside him, slept in wild places, flown difficult times. Sean was inevitably the pilot of the camera ship when... Could I have a sip of that Sprite, please? Thanks. Sean was inevitably the pilot in a camera ship when any of us here at Sling were trying to make a film. And people often come up to me and they say to me, "James, when you and Mike were out there in the wilds of Namibia in your tail dragger, landing on all of those impossible runways, who the hell was filming you, you know?" And then I always have to look a little bit sheepish and say, "Well, You know, we had alongside us Sean Russell flying with a cameraman, and he was in the shitty old Sling 4, loaded up to the roof with camping gear, camera equipment, extra fuel, and of course he landed at every single place that we landed at just afterwards, and quite often actually just ahead of us. So, I mean, Sean was an absolutely wonderful and natural pilot. He wore an aeroplane like most people wear an article of clothing, and he loved more than just about anything to share the love of flying with other people. So lots of people have a wonderful opportunity to have experienced that with him. I mean, some of you will know that Sean's first go at the controls of a real aircraft, he was already, I understand, a very accomplished radio control pilot, and I think a South African radio control champion, was when he borrowed a Motor Falk motor glider aeroplane, aged just 12 years old, and while he was at the Fishhook Primary School, his plan was to fly to Johannesburg from Cape Town in this aeroplane to visit his mother. You know, he has always been a great family man. He successfully took off from Versantekraal on his first flight ever at the controls of an aircraft. He flew it to Laingsburg, landed on the road outside, they refueled, took off successfully again, and ended up settling in a field on a farmer's farm in Swellendam. Everybody sound and in good health. So the world press was hugely impressed by that. It was in all of the press across Europe and I believe North America. The South African courts apparently were not as delighted by that. But I can hardly imagine that in today's world, there's a 12-year-old, you know, a millennial or a Gen Z, whatever it is, who, having never piloted an airplane, would ever be able to get that right. Feels to me like it was in Sean's blood, absolutely right from the start. They say that you can judge a man by his friends, and I think that the turnout here today is a demonstration of the love that all of us bear for Sean Russell. Sean, we will miss you terribly at Sling Aircraft. Sean was the first one up every day. He had a smile on his face, and he would open the door of the office here even before you arrived at it. But Paul, Mandy, and especially Shannon, the undisputed love of Sean's life, an apple in his eye, we just can't imagine the sadness that you must be feeling. We are, all of us, everyone here today with you, and we will be supporting you as you face the days and weeks ahead. You can feel so proud of your father and your brother and the love that he earned from all of us. Sean loved to watch aeroplanes, and we're putting up a bench with a memorial plaque for him in the next week, somewhere on the south side of the airfield, I think in the long grass over there, looking north towards the sun, so that all of you who want to come and commune with Sean and watch aeroplanes with him in the evening can do that, and you're all invited to do so. You can phone me to open the gate. Fly high, our friend.
Thank you, James.
I think, once again, a whole lot of things that I felt very much about Sean have been said. And one that hasn't been mentioned, well, kind of has, but is how selfless he was. That he would rather look after other people before he looked after himself. And it reminds me of another Sling Africa tour. I can see him, Tandeni was on that trip. We were camping quite a lot, and in Swakopmund, I had my sleeping bag and my mattress stolen. Sean said, no problem, we'll share a sleeping bag and we'll share a tent. So for the next 5 days, I'll remind you, the desert gets cold at night. For the next 5 days, Sean and I would put all our clothes on, lock into each other like lovers, put the one sleeping bag over us, and shiver through the night. Thank you, Sean. You kept me alive that trip. Next up, I'm going to call Warren Jones to come and speak. Before I do, though, I want to say, James, I think if there is somebody else who could possibly have taken an airplane age 13, it would be Shannon, because Sean spent his life teaching Shannon how to fly. And when it came time for her to do proper instruction and go solo at age 17, Sean entrusted Warren to be her instructor. And so Warren and Sean and Shannon have spent a lot of time together and have become very close. Warren.
Oh, wow. You're so tall. Hello, hello. There we go. Where do you start? The hardest thing about Sean is to try and sift through all the stories. He's had one hell of a laugh, one hell of an adventure. The world unfortunately has to say goodbye to one of the most amazing pilots. He really did strap on an aeroplane. I mean, you could start an aircraft here, he would listen to it and he'd be like, lane B is grounded or whatever the case may be. He just had an unnatural talent, and anyone who he worked for, I mean, they would have been so lucky. Sean and I spent a lot of time out of aviation together, and I'll never forget the one time, there's a place up the road here called Johnny's, and we decided we're going to sulky together, and all those Afrikaans guys were not too happy about it, so he thought, well, let me give Warren a kiss, and he thought, it's a good idea to give me kisses all over. We almost got ourselves blixened and burned out the pub. Unfortunately, like I say, we have to say our goodbyes. But I know Sean... Oh, sorry. Sean would rather you don't say goodbye. He would prefer you say hello. Hello to the next chapter of your life, because it's not a goodbye forever. He will always love you. He will always love Shannon and you, Mandy. He always spoke highly of both of you. And unfortunately, this story of life is, in a wink of an eye. And everything, it's in the front pocket. Okay. I'll end this off pretty quickly. Sean, you weren't just a star to the people that you loved. You were actually their whole damn scar. And that's fine. Thank you.
Thanks, Warren. Thank you, Warren. Of course, in addition to his beloved family and the squadron of friends that Sean had made over the years, there were some other very special people in Sean's life. For the last 5 years, Danny, his girlfriend, and Olivia, her daughter, have been a huge part of Sean's life. Olivia calls him Dad, and this is a difficult time for them too. So I've asked Danny if she won't come up and say just a couple of words and read a poem. And if you're not up to it, I can read it for you. Danny. Thought you'd memorized it.
No, not so lucky. Thanks, Andrew. Can everyone hear me? For Olivia and myself, it started 4 years ago. We were quite content in our little grey world when this colourful man adamantly decided to become a part of it all. He quickly snuck into our hearts, and the rest became history. Sean was incredibly passionate about many things: his family, his flying, and just about everything that he loved. Nothing was too big for him or too much. He loved the challenge. He was patient, patient with me, patient with Shani, patient with Olivia, even with the countless hours he spent answering all her questions during the why phase.
Shawnee, thank you for taking Olivia under your wing and sharing all your firsts with me, all her firsts with me. Thank you for teaching her so many invaluable lessons in life. Share so many magical memories with you that will last a lifetime. I'll never forget when during the first week of her new school, he towed her a banner reading, "We love you, Olivia," just to alert people to the fact that her Shawnee's watching them. And also, she needed some confidence in the new scary world. You changed my world too, and you made it a brighter place. We shared so many memories, adventures, countless laughs, tears too, but most of all, an unconditional love. Sean loved with all his heart, and because of that, our once gray world is now full of color. A gentleman is one who puts more into the world than he takes out, and that was Sean. Shani, thank you for sharing your incredible dad with us. Shawnee will always be deeply loved, sorely missed, and remain imprinted in our hearts. I have a poem that I think is very fitting for Shawnee. I don't know what it's called, and I don't know who wrote it. I'm sorry for being ambitious, wanting more hours, more ratings, bigger, better, faster, lower. I'm sorry for being overly brave. Men weren't meant to fly, yet within me, I know that's what I was born to do. I'm sorry for being so comfortable. I wish you could understand that to me, home is synonymous with the sky. I'm sorry for being too daring. Clouds, mountain peaks, and unmanned gravel runways make up my playground. I'm sorry for being unable to be earthbound. My hours are spent a few thousand feet up where my dreams come to life. I'm sorry for being fearless. The danger is ever present, but my hunger is never satisfied. I'm sorry for being grumpy when stuck on the ground. Flying is what keeps my heart beating. I'm sorry for your horrifying dreams, imprisoned in fear while I rejoice in the freedom of blue skies. I'm sorry for being inconsiderate. Never took the time to realize that my key to happiness is the subject of all your prayers. I'm sorry for being juvenile. Please understand, amongst the heavens, I will forever remain etched with childlike curiosity. I'm sorry for keeping such a large group close to me. Just me. Wouldn't that have been easy on you? I'm sorry for seeming lost among the earth dwellers. The DI knows where I want to be and leads me there without fail. I'm sorry for making you love me. How selfish. Knowing that our adoration would have an expiration date, decided not by me or you, but by the roaring engine. I'm sorry for being mesmerized. Magic is a reality for an aviator, and the world a masterpiece. I'm sorry for not being content on the ground. I lost my heart while dancing with the wind. I'm sorry for being passionate. Know that if my passion were to take my life, to me it was a worthwhile trade. I'm sorry for not quitting while ahead. One more flight, one more hour, one more chance to be free from earthly worries. I'm sorry for your restless nights. No man was born to be one with machine. But machine is all I trust, and machine my life preserves. I'm sorry for testing fate. Though my path never made me less mortal than you, or you more immortal than me. I'm sorry for this unusual love affair. Words could never do the beauty of flying justice. Neither could I explain the serenity it brings me. I'm sorry for allowing such vulnerability. My life's end is beyond my control. It has become proportional to the lifespan of my trusted and your dreaded silver wings. I'm sorry for the whirlwind this life has caused. Here today, gone the next. Figuratively, literally. I'm sorry for my xenodochial disposition, devoting my life to those who owe me less than nothing. Funny how I wouldn't have it any other way. I'm sorry you will be left with the aftermath. Way up, surrounded by endless horizons, weather my last flight, know my soul and I will always be at peace. I'm sorry for my zealous outlook. See, these have been the best days of my life. If flying ever were my life to take, know that I left content. I'm sorry that your heart is grieving. whereas mine, please believe, my heart is finally where it belongs. Thank you.
Thank you, Danny. I know how tough this is for you and Olivia too. And for a whole lot of people, young people, my son Harry loved Sean, called him Uncle Sean. Didn't really realize that because he's got Uncle James and Uncle Guy and Uncle Murray and Uncle Scott, he didn't realize that Sean wasn't actually a real uncle. He thought Uncle Sean was a real uncle. And so on the Wednesday when I came home to explain to Harry that Uncle Sean had had an accident and died, Harry looked at me deep in the eyes and he said, "But Daddy, Sling can't run without Sean, so can we change your name to Uncle Sean?" Next up is Shannon's turn. But before I get Shannon's speech from her, I think we're playing a video that I'd like you all to watch in silence, please. Over to AV. So this is who I am.
Ha ha ha!
That was moving. Well done, Shan. Do you want to come and stand next to me? Stand up here next to me. So Shan has written this, but I'm going to read it because she's, of course, very emotional. And I'm going to read it as if it's from her. Daddy, no words I say today could ever come close to how much you meant to me. I never thought I would be standing in front of friends and family so soon to say my final goodbye. We have shared so many amazing memories and adventures together in the very short time we had. I can definitely say we made the best of the 18 years I knew you. I remember you going out early in the morning before the sunrise to go fly your microlight and only come back after sun had risen, which left me adamant that, Daddy, you went to go wake up the sun. Daddy, you were not only my dad, but you were and will always be my best friend, my inspiration, my motivation, and my role model. You were always so passionate about flying, which made it contagious. You were always so willing to share your love for flying with everyone. Daddy, I'm going to miss our spontaneous getaway trips. All our flights where we worked as the perfect team, however those flights came, with very long and descriptive lectures on the ways. I will always miss our urge to always race each other with anything that had an engine. You will always be known as the troublemaker, like gluing Smarties to my mom's new dining room table, or using her house ornaments as parts for the train you built to hand out to sweets to children in the neighborhood, of course. I was with your eager accomplice. You've taught me everything from flying planes to riding motorbikes, driving cars. However, you didn't teach me the hardest lesson in life, and that was learning to live without you. Besides being a loving father, you were an amazing friend to many, a wild child of a brother, and an overall adrenaline junkie. You'll always be remembered as the man that had the cheesiest playlist, which we have all had the privilege of listening to one last time today. It hurts to know that you have left us so soon, and I know I can safely say for many that you have left a huge legacy behind that no one will ever be able to live up to. You went doing what you loved most, and I know you will continue to fly high as you watch down on us. I will always love you forever, Daddy, and it seems you will always be sitting in the chair, always be sitting in the right seat, watching over me and criticizing me as I saw the skies making you so proud. Well done. Beautiful, Shannon. So in addition to the hundreds of emails and WhatsApps that collectively James, Mike, myself, and the Sling team have received, there are some people who happen to luckily be here because they have amazing access and have asked if they could say a couple of words themselves. I'm not going to open the floor to everybody, but I would like to firstly invite Linda Sollers up to come and say a couple of words. Linda was our very first Sling High Wing customer, and she spent, I was going to say months, but a year building her plane here, spending time with Sean. Sean taught her to fly it. Sean then went and joined the Menosh Kosh and spent more time with Linda. So if I could ask Linda Sollers to please come up.
Hello. Well, I'm so very honored to be included in this tribute to one of the most amazing people And if you haven't got your bets in yet as to whether I'll make it through without bawling my eyes out, and I'm really ugly when I cry, now's your last chance. Well, while Sean was so much more than his work for Sling, it's through that context that I had the great honor to get to know and get close to him. I'm going to be independently and unintentionally redundant when I say Sean didn't fly airplanes, he wore them. They were an extension of his very being. And I referred to him as the Sling Whisperer. With his eyes slightly narrowed, he would listen to the sound and the vibration and whatever language the plane wanted to talk to him in. And he would figure out exactly what was wrong. And he was always right. And it was amazing. As most of you know, especially now, I built the first high wing here, beginning in 2021. Sean taught me to fly the prototype. He patiently answered my questions on the design, the build, and the maintenance. And thanks to his tremendous talent, the Sling High Wing is a better product. I'm a better pilot, a better builder, and a better mechanic. And I felt comfortable flying that plane across the Atlantic because I knew Sean had inspected it. And I admire his devotion to his family. You could see the pride in his eyes. And the love in his smile that came straight from his heart for Shannon. And his devotion was evident in the extraordinary individual that Shannon is. His soft, sweet side was evident in the way he was with Olivia and with Danny in the way he showered flowers on her all the time. I have and will always hear his voice every time I start my airplane. And I look forward to the time that evolves from heartbreaking to a cherished memory. Sean, my friend, you will be missed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Linda. I guess some of you here don't know him, but a lot of you here will know him, and I'm springing this on him. But one of Sean's greatest mentors and greatest friends in the world is a guy called Jean de Assenville. And Jean moved over to America to run the Sling distributorship and start up the Sling Pilots Academy in Torrance in California. And Jean, as a surprise, has flown out for the memorial service. So Jean, I need you to come and make up some words, please.
I know what I'm crying. I'm going to try. So, you know, I'm really thankful that I could actually put it together to get out here. Hold it. I was going to not come and driving on PCH on Thursday morning, I said, I'm going. Got to work, booked a ticket, and since Thursday, I've been on the plane. This is wild. I mean, I never thought I'd be up here doing this. Shawnee, yeah. Sorry, guys. But sitting over the Atlantic last night, I wrote some notes. I'm going to try and kind of just go through the notes. I'm kind of get my head together, yeah, but I'm going to start off by saying forever. We don't just live here for a certain amount of time. We're here forever. So I'm going to head it as forever, forever legends, forever friends, and forever around. I think everyone here, everyone out there listening to us, You can call Sean a friend. I'm going to get through this. I'm going to get through it. Because that's what Sean was. Sean was a friend to everyone. He might have flown to someone in a plane for 10 minutes, but he was a friend. And that's how we're going to remember Sean forever. From the very first moment I met Sean, I liked him, and I very quickly got to love Sean. And I'm not the only one. I think anyone that knew Sean got to love Sean, and that's why we all yeah, so many of us. Sean was always happy to jump in and help, jump in and serve the flying corps, regardless of the cost to him. Just get it done. That's how we all know him, completely selfless. But there was one place in his heart, one very big place, that had no room for negotiation, nada, nothing, aziko. That place, that room in his heart, that very big room that ruled by his soul, is the room for his little princess. And we know that room remains, and will always remain. It is for this most infinite, precious, and admirable quality of our legendary friend that I will forever remember and respect him. I've yet to see a father and a daughter so closely entwined. Shawnee, always a father to Shani, but their own magic is in the true friendship they share. I had the pleasure, and it was a true pleasure, to be able to spend a lot of time with Sean. We lived up on the hill there. He was a housemate, and Shani spent hours and hours there. And the shenanigans we got up to, we ruled that hill day and night. Weekends were amazing. I'd look forward to every Friday night for Shani to come around, and we'd do such amazing things, so many stories, not to tell now, but maybe later. Sean, as we all know, all his qualities have been discussed here, and you know, we know what Sean was. He was a phenomenal pilot. I realized that the day I was actually sitting over here in an airplane, and this helicopter arrived. Sean had only been working for us for a short time. And it arrived and disappeared past the hangar. And I sat there, I wonder who that was. And then it reversed, I saw it reversing. And then it turned, it looked at me, and it went up and down, and turned, did a little dance, and then disappeared behind the hangar again. And that was Sean. And that's when I realized, yeah, he's a natural. And from that day on, every single time I went flying, I took Sean with, and he became this phenomenal test pilot. And it was through Shawnee that I was able to go have my life I have in the USA. Sean looked after things here far better than I could ever have. So, you know, Sean lives forever. Everyone that has flown the Sean will always have Sean next. If they've flown in an airplane with him, whenever they fly, they'll have Sean there saying, do that, slow down, put out flaps, do this, don't do that. Kind of thing, so he'll live with them. And then all the people here at the factory that worked with Sean, you know, Sean did inspections, and he was 100% strict. You know, we live
we work in a business where it's kind of zero
defect. And, you know, I think everyone that worked with Sean will always remember it when they're working. They'll have Sean over here, and, you know, he'll be there forever. And that brings me to our other friend, Vince. You know, Vince, I wish I could see Vince one more time. But Vince and Sean have joined forces up there now, and each one of us, those two little guardian angels with us, when we do anything with airplanes, they'll be there forever, forever legends, until we meet again. Viva!
Thank you very much, Sean. To sort of end the formal proceedings, and before you can go and charge your glasses and get another drink, we want to show a video that Shannon has put together of her and her dad over the last 18 years. And so please could you watch the video in silence, and then as soon as it's done, you can go and get a drink in preparation for the missing man formation.
When I think back on these times and the dreams we left behind, I'll be glad, 'cause I was blessed to get to have you in my life. When I look back on these days, I'll look and see your face. You were right there for me. In my dreams, I'll always see you soar above the sky. In my heart, there'll always be a place for you for all my life. I'll keep a part of you with me, and everywhere I am, there you'll be.
What a beautiful life it looks like you've lived so far, Shan. That's the end of the formal proceedings. So please go help yourself to another drink. And if you can bear it, the only thing that Sean had a worse taste in music of is his taste in beer. So if you can bear to drink a Black Label, I can see Tom's got one there. Please get a Black Label. And socialize and chat until the Missing Man formation is ready for us. Thank you very much, everybody.
Everybody needs a little time away. I've heard her say from each other, even lovers need a holiday. Far away from each other. It's hard for me to say I'm sorry. I just want you to stay. After all that we've been through, I will make it up to you.
That is so cool. And then did the messages all sit up there? How many we got?
Thank you. It's like angels are singing, you're bringing me down. When you leave, my colors turn to gray. Numa, numa, yeah. Numa, 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 yeah. Every word of love I used to say, now I paint them every day. When you leave, my colors turn to gray. Numa, numa, yeah. Numa, 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 yeah. Every word of love I used to say, now
That is so cool.
Now's the time to take a moment and realize you've got to catch it before it passes on by, out of sight, out of sight. So follow me, I'll show you places you never see. Hold on tight, we'll take the keep you safe. Thank you.
Thank you.